Is Krakoa ready to partake in its greatest advancement yet as a nation? Well, let's hop into the pages of Planet Size X-Men issue number 1 from Jerry Duggan and find out together, shall we? Alrighty then, so this special extra length issue serves as both an epilogue to the events of the Hellfire Gala taking place both during, before, and after that story, as well as perhaps a special little look forward to what we can expect in the Jerry Duggan X-Men book as we join things Magneto and a detachment of mutants are on Mars. What are they doing? Not much, just using their amazing mutant abilities to terraform the planet so it can be livable and part of the ever-growing Krakoan Empire. You know, not much at all. What's that? We just need to add a little bit more metal to the core to help make the planet livable? Not a problem, we can do that. In fact, they choose to do all of this while the Hellfire Gala is still going on. You'll remember at the end of the previous issue I had mentioned how I thought there was something kind of strange about how Emma Frost talked about the fireworks going on. Well, it seems that all of this planet stuff is happening at the same time as that. Meaning that the whole fancy gala party just wasn't an excuse for mutant kind to show off to their friends and enemies alike, but it was also a way to make sure everyone was all together in the same place to see what might very well be their greatest achievement yet, full space colonization. But why Mars and why now? Well, for that, we actually end up stepping back in time a little bit. We see Magneto taking a meeting with Iska the Undefeated. You'll recall that at the end of X of Swords, Krakoa had joined with its sister island, Eriko. The only problem is that the Eriko mutants are a lot more savage, a lot more warrior-based in their culture, and it seems that they're making trouble for the humans, actually subjugating parts of Japan just because they liked the whiskey that they made there. In fact, they're becoming such a problem that even Captain America of the Avengers has reached on out to Cyclops in the first time that these two have actually talked for a very long time, and hey, fun venue they chose to meet in upstate New York at the old X-Mansion. Steve talks about how much Krakoa has grown and all the new mutants the island is hosting right now, and how the rest of the world is kind of on the edge of their seat right now, worried about what might happen next. These international problems are further compounded by the mutants' brand new miracle drugs. As we hear from the Hellfire Trading Company, they can't make enough quick enough because the humans' hunger for it is bottomless. If mutant kind is gonna make more, they're gonna need more land, more resources, and well, they just don't have any of that on Earth right now, so instead, they've decided to look elsewhere. In fact, the way Magneto makes it sound, colonizing Mars has been on the mutants' to-do list for a while. It's one of the major reasons they wanted to recruit Franklin Richards of the Fantastic Four. Obviously, that plan had to be thrown out the window once it was revealed that he wasn't actually a mutant at all. This means that Eric and the other Terraformers find themselves in a rather precarious situation, looking to Eriko for help. Luckily for them, those mutants have some of the strangest and most out there mutant powers yet. Like the fish man who manages to provide enough water to help bring the planet back to life simply by cutting himself. Yes, he had the mutant power to have an ocean inside him. With enough water on the planet, Storm is actually able to use her amazing Omega level weather powers to get an actual real atmosphere going on, so people can actually live and breathe. Then, of course, there's the matter of livable, farmable soil. Luckily, Eriko had themselves a big, gross worm mutant who can eat up all the soil matter on the planet right now, concentrate it through himself, and cultivate something usable with the help of Elixir. Magneto gloats, saying something that would take Mother Nature millions of years takes mutants mere hours when they all work together. Of course, the question does eventually end up getting breached. Won't humanity and planet Earth end up getting upset that mutant kind essentially stole a whole planet in the solar system for themselves? Magneto fires back in a wonderfully dismissive tone, saying, oh yeah, humanity was definitely gonna colonize Mars any day now. Oh yeah, that was definitely on their list behind everything else they were doing. Essentially, the Krakoan mutants are invoking the ancient right of you snooze, you lose, losers. But here's the thing though, as we discover, Mars is actually not meant for the mutants of Krakoa. Instead, it's actually meant for the mutants of Eriko, their kind of reward for holding the line against demon kind back in the day. A peaceful new world where they'll hopefully not feel the need to conquer, or at the very least war with each other and leave Chuck and the other mutants unscathed. This, of course, also begs the question, if the UN was willing to recognize Krakoa as a nation, does that mean they're also going to need to recognize planet Eriko? By the time everything is said and done, even Jamie Braddock ends up getting in on the action. Gene incepts the idea in his head to create a brand new Sword 2 space station to serve as a bulwark between mutant kind and the Earth and whatever evil may exist out there in alien space. And because he's such in a good mood, he opts to even go a step further by creating a brand new Prometheus port for any alien visitor who wishes to come and do business with mutant kind. And yeah, that's more or less where the comic comes to an end right there. Krakoa and mutant kind have completely changed the fabric of space. The Errico mutants now finally have a brand new home to call their own. And as if they even needed it, more eyes than ever are on mutant kind and what they might very well do next in this brand new golden age as the reign of X continues. And so that was Planet Size X-Men issue number 1, everybody. If you couldn't tell, I thought this was a super cool issue in a series that has been filled with oh so many cool issues like this one. Duggan really leans hard into the science fiction and basically says, hey, with mutant powers, anything is possible, so what's the most amazing thing the mutants could possibly do? Make a whole planet livable. It makes sense. Orches, the number one enemies of mutant kind, are also operating in space, so why shouldn't the mutants want to one-up them by having their own planet? The question does remain, though, can the mutants of Errico be trusted? They've been shown to be vicious and warlike before. Will someone have to be there to keep tabs on them to make sure they don't start invading other planets, or is that just inevitable? How will this affect the Hellfire Trading Company and X-Corp now that they essentially have a whole planet's worth of resources prime for the taking? Will the Shi'ar Empire or the brand new Kree-Skrull Union be cool with the idea of the X-Men having their own planet to themselves? Only time will tell, I guess. Overall, I'd feel comfortable giving this one a very positive 9 out of 10. It was a super fun read.
Hey there, everyone. Kate Joel again, and I just want to thank you so much for watching to the end of the video. It means a lot to me. And hey, if you enjoyed the book I covered in this issue and want some comics of your own, might I recommend Book Depository? It's my number one place for shopping for comic book trades. You get a great price, and if you use my link down in the description, you'll actually be helping me out at the same time. You get something, I get something, everybody wins, right? So until next time, everyone, I've been Joel, and I will see you in the next video. Bye-bye.